First statement, it is a right statement, and if we go through the second statement, it is not an ancient indigenous institution, it must be considered as a medieval institution. Okay, here whenever we will go through the statement 2, here we can come across statement 2, thereby where we can eliminate it, and then here also we can come across 2. Then what about the answer, what about third statement, the office of Mir Bakshi? It is also wrong statement. Then answer must be one only. Okay, correct. But whenever we will go through this Amil Noor, try to remember here there are three important terminologies are there. Just you try to jot down from prelims perspective. I want to substantiate from your prelims perspective. Amil, Amul Guzar, Karori. Always try to remember these three important terminologies from prelims perspective. Amil, Amul Guzar and Karori, all the three important official positions attributed to revenue administration. Attributed to revenue administration. Okay. Amil, Amul Guzari and Karori. Suppose if they ask a question with regard to Karori, just you had one important point. The official position Karori was first created by great Mughal ruler Akbar, who created this official position for the first time in the arena of revenue administration. Means, please try to remember Akbar. Okay, and two more words associated with this revenue administration, Bitchi. Then don't think that where they have formulated question out of syllabus. No, within syllabus only. Okay, Bidchi and Kunangu. Bidchi and Kunangu. Try to remember. Bidchi and Kunangu. Bidchi and Kunangu. Officers who were in charge of revenue records. Bidchi and Kunango, the officers were in charge of revenue records. And one more important official position associated with this, Kazandar. That's Saltarian's thematic. Kazandar. If you go through any question, you must have crystal clear clarity in your mind. Kazandar. Who was Kazandar? The name itself signifies the role of an officer. Jot down, in charge of treasury. Okay, he was in charge of treasury. That's all. There ends the matter. Okay, and if you go through the ICTA system, I already mentioned who was the first ruler who constituted ICTA system or created or incorporated, Mohammed Ghor. But it was institutionalized on organic basis by Iltutmish. Okay, Iltutmish. Then office of Mir Bakshi, rather than Mir Bakshi. Here, if they incorporate R.E.C. Mammalik, always try to remember R.E.C. Mammalik, the head of military institution during the rule of Khiljis, it was popularly called as R.E.C. Mammalik. Who created military department for the first time? Balban. Balban was the first ruler who created military department. It was headed by R.E.C. Mammalik. Answer must be one only. Is it clear? No? Is it clear? This question is clear. Then we will move on to second question. Pawazil in the Sultanate period meant. Title Pawazil. What about Pawazil? See, try to understand it. See, this is a real content. This is a real content. Pawazil. What was the meaning of Pawazil? If you know the meaning of Pawazil, it is very easy to answer. Correct? I remember. Here what they have given? Extra payment to the nobles. No, it is not at all having any relevance with the term or with the concept Pawazil. Okay. And then second one. Revenue assigned in lieu of salary. Whenever the revenue assigned in lieu of salary for your kind information. Why they constituted ICTA means the ICTAs are the special territories which were assigned to the military personnel in lieu of their salaries and allowances. Correct? Try to remember. thereby where ikta can be interpreted in two ways during Delhi Sultanate period, one which is pertaining to military administration, another which is pertaining to provincial administration. Okay, in two perspectives where we can discuss with regard to ikta system. Then revenue assigned in lieu of salary, excess amount paid to the exchequer by the iktadars. Excess amount paid to the exchequer by the iktadars. That is right statement. See, whatever the salaries and allowances, it was disbursed among the military personnel or military officers, whatever the remaining amount which has been remitted to the exchequer or the treasury, that in turn considered as pawasil. Try to remember. Are you getting my point? See here, the excess amount paid to the exchequer by the iktadars, whatever the remaining amount when it was remitted to the treasury, where that concept was popularly called as pawasil. We have already discussed in the classroom, okay, while dealing with the Delhi Sultanate administration, for your kind information. Okay, thereby, which must be the right choice? C must be the right choice. And then illegal exactions extracted from the peasant. Definitely we can come across the exploitative measures imbibed by the rulers during medieval period. That's why not only in contemporary societies we can come across agrarian crisis or agrarian unrest, even during medieval period also we can come across with regard to agrarian crisis or agrarian unrest. Okay, that is mainly because of the exploitative measures assimilated by the medieval rulers. Then which choice is a perfect choice here? Excess amount paid to the exchequer by the iktadars. Is it clear? Then match list to and select the correct answer using the codes given below the list. See, this has been asked several times here. Try to understand this. This question, it is a stereotyped question. It has got so much of relevance in your preparations. Then, see, ikta. We have already studied. Try to match ikta. See, whenever you will go through the ikta, whenever we will go through ikta, ikta, it always associated with Delhi Sultanates. Okay, please try to remember. Thereby, A2, where we can come across A2, C, okay, and B. Then we can easily eliminate A and D. Correct? Yeah, it's very easy here. Try to imbibe the tools and techniques of elimination. If you imbibe the tools and techniques of elimination, it is so easier to face prelims. Yeah, it's very easy. It is like a cakewalk. It is like a cakewalk. Why we have to worry? Then Jagir. So easy. Okay. Ikta ascribed to Delhi Sultanates. The Jagirs ascribed to Mughals. Correct? I remember. Jagir Dars. Isn't it? We have already studied. Whenever we will go through Jagir, Mughals. B3. Where we can come across B3? B. Correct? Okay, and then Amaram. You must know. What about Amaram? Amaram Vijayanagara. Okay. What about this Amaram? What is the significance of this Amaram? Just you had one important point. During Vijayanagara rule, Amaram considered as feudal unit. You must remember. They may ask this statement in your examinations. And remember, Amara considered as the feudal component of Vijayanagara rule. Feudal component. The feudal unit of Vijayanagara Empire. Okay, try to remember. Feudal unit. But whenever you will go through this Amaram, where this Amaram, it was very much having relevance with, jot down, Amara Nayaka system. Amara Nayaka system. Amara Nayaka. Yeah. They may ask, Amara Nayaka system associated with which rule means Vijayanagara Empire or Vijayanagara rule. Okay, Amara Nayaka system. Amarams means the special lands or the special areas which were assigned to military personnel, where at that time the military personnel was popularly called as Nayaks. Okay, try to remember. That's why it was popularly called as Amaranayaka system. But it is an integral part of feudal administration. Okay, try to remember. Thereby, it must be considered as a feudal component of Vijayanagara. And then Mokasa. Mokasa. Marathas. Yeah, Mokasa. Definitely, it must be considered as Marathas. Mokasas. See, like Jagir, like Ikta, as well as Amaram, the Mokasa, it must also be considered as a concept of feudalism. Try to remember, Mokasa, it was during Marathas rule. And one more important terminology where we can come across during Marathas, Swarajya. Try to remember, the Swarajya. During the rule of Marathas, who incorporated the concept of Swarajya means the great Maratha ruler Shivaji. Okay, try to remember. Is it clear? Every time where they used to ask for one way or the other way. Okay. Next we will move on to one more important question. With reference to medieval Indian rulers, which one of the following statement is correct? Okay, try to understand. Which one of the following statement is correct? Alauddin Khilji first set up a separate Aris department. Okay. Alauddin Khilji first set up a separate Aris department. Balban introduced branding of horses in his military. Okay, try to remember. And then Muhammad bin Tughlaq was succeeded by his uncle to the military. Okay, and then next, Firoz Tughlaq set up a separate department of slaves. What about choices here? What about choices here? With reference to medieval Indian rulers, which one of the following statement is correct? See here, Alauddin Khilji first set up separate Aris. No, Diwani Aris, the military department was first set up by Balban. Correct, I remember. And Balban branding of horses by Alauddin Khilji. Correct, I remember. Muhammad bin Tughlaq was succeeded by his uncle to the military. No way. Try to understand this. Firoz Tughlaq set up a separate department of slaves. Definitely. Where the department was popularly called as Diwan-e-Bandagani. Diwan-e-Bandagani. Then which statement must considered as a correct statement or right statement? D. Okay. Yeah, thereby just we can come across. See here, if you go through the real content, Aris, correct? Here the real content, branding. Yeah, try to identify the real content. Then it is so easy. Please try to remember. And then succeeded. Then Firoz Shah Tughlaq set up a separate department of slaves. But one should understand the meaning of the word Bandagani. Okay. If you know the meaning of the term or the concept Bandagani, it is very easy to opt for right choice. Okay. Clear. Then Mongols under Chengiz Khan invaded India during the reign of. See, in medieval Indian history, one should understand the basic nuances pertaining to Mongols. Why Mongols means there was at regular intervals, there was incursion of Mongols into the territories of the Delhi Sultanates. Correct, I remember. Incursion or infiltration of Mongols, for your kind information, pardon me, Mongols. Whenever we'll go through this, Mongols under Chengiz Khan invaded India during the reign of Balban, Firoz Shah Tughlaq, Iltutmish, Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Try to remember. When for the first time incursion of Mongols? Iltutmish. Is it clear?
Yes,
Iltutmish. Please try to remember. Is it not we can come across the incursion of Mongols during Balban?
Yes.
Correct. Balban. Because Balban was a ruler who formulated a two-pronged strategy. One is policy of aggression and another is a policy of diplomacy. Correct. I remember. Two-pronged strategy for your kind information. Thereby we can also come across the incursion of Mongols. Even Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Why Muhammad bin Tughlaq shifted capital from Delhi to Devagiri? Correct. I remember. There, the scholars, they also given an important reason to prevent the invasions by Mongols. Correct, I remember. In order to provide the defensive mechanism, thereby where he shifted the capital from Delhi to Devagiri. Correct, I remember. Where he found Devagiri as a safe haven against the Mongols. Correct, I remember. Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Then answer must be Iltutmish. Yeah, there ends the matter. Answer must be Iltutmish. Next. Which of the following fairs is correctly matched? Sipa. Yeah. In medieval Indian history, administrative system. If you are going through medieval Indian history, without fail, there are three important administrative systems. Vijayanagara, Delhi Sultanates, and Mughals. Yeah, try to understand. Diwani Bandagani. Tughlaq. Is it correct?
Yes.
Yes. Diwani Bandagani Tughlaq. Correct. How come here? How come? Just to know, we have discussed. Who created Department of Diwani Bandagani? Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Just why I have created that confusion in the minds of my students means, here you only mentioned just Tughlaq. Correct. That's why. What you must mention? Firoz Shah Tughlaq you must mention. Correct. Try to understand this. That's why. Diwani Mustaq Raj. Is it Balban? No. Alauddin Khilji, correct, I remember. And then Diwani Koi, is it Alauddin Khilji? No way. Who created it? Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Why? Because where this Diwani Koi, Diwani Amir Koi, it must be considered as agricultural department. I remember where for the first time he created agricultural department in the form of Diwani Amir Koi. Through this agricultural department, where he also introduced Swandar. What was the meaning of Swandar? What was the meaning of Swandar? Huh? What was the meaning of Swandar? Oh. Granted subsidized agricultural loans. The word Swandar means the subsidized agricultural loans to rejuvenate, to replenish agricultural activities during the rule of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. But who incorporated the concept of the subsidized agricultural loans means, please always try to remember, Alauddin Khilji, in the form of a concept called as Takavi. Okay, Takavi. Takavi. Try to understand. A subsidized agricultural loan, it was first incorporated or introduced by Alauddin Khilji in the form of Takavi. Okay. But if they change the nomenclature, then it must be Swandar. UPSC people, they are so clever here. Why? To eliminate the candidates from the pre. And remember, they are so clever. Yeah. You must have the defensive mechanism in the form of what? Content consolidation. Okay. Clear now? Diwani Aris. Diwani Aris, definitely Balban. No doubt in that. Consider the following events. Oh, this is also an easy question here. Reign of Krishna Deva of Vijayanagara. From mains point of view, from prelims point of view, where you can expect questions from Vijayanagara Empire. No doubt in that. The reign of Krishna Devaraya of Vijayanagara. What about reign of Krishna Devaraya? Huh? What about reign of Krishna Devaraya? 1529, the reign of Krishna Devaraya. Okay. Construction of Kutub Minar. Construction of Kutub Minar. When the construction of Kutub Minar was first started, the foundation was laid Kutubuddin Aibak. Foundation was laid by Kutubuddin Aibak, the founder of Delhi Sultanate. Okay. Or slave dynasty. Correct. I remember. Then when we go through the construction of Kutub Minar, several aspirants where they used to consolidate the foundation of Kutub Minar from 1206. Why 1206? Because the 1206, it signifies the fundamental foundation of slave dynasty that in turn favored the way for inception of Delhi Sultanate rule. Correct, I remember. Is it in 1206 the Kutubuddin Aibak he started the construction of Kutub Minar? Then when? This is what you must learn. Because it is like arrange the following. See, correct the chronological sequence of these events. Correct chronological. Chronological dating of events. This is what. Is it not they are asking questions? Definitely they are asking questions. Yeah. See, it was first started in 1197 AD. At that time, who was the ruler? Muhammad Ghori. Then who was Kutubuddin Aibak at that time? He was a slave. Yeah. Rather than year onwards, don't use the word slave. Title number subservient. I already mentioned. Subservient. Correct title number. Subservient. Then arrival of Portuguese in India.
1490.
Okay. Arrival of Portuguese in India. Who was that Portuguese? Vasco da Gama. Correct. Title remember. Death of Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Death of Firoz Shah Tughlaq. It's so easy, pa. Reign of Krishna Devaraya, 16th century. Correct. Try to remember. And then construction of Qutub Minar, it started 12th century. Okay. Try to remember. End of 12th century. Arrival of Portuguese, 15th century. Correct. Try to remember. And then death of Firoz Shah Tughlaq. What about timeline of Firoz Shah Tughlaq? 1351 to 1388. Correct. Try to remember. 1351 to 1388. That means 14th century AD. Correct. Which must be the first one? Yes. Among four? Which must be the first among four? Two must be there. Okay. Two. Year two. We can easily eliminate this. Then, next, after construction of Qutub Minar, what about next? Death of Firoz Shah Tughlaq, 4. Then where we can come across 4? 2 and 4 in both choices are there. This is what the nature of UPSC questions. One should understand the nature or the basic attribute of UPSC. One should touch the pulse of UPSC. Yeah, that radial artery. You must touch the radial artery of UPSC. Then success will comes and falls to your feet immediately. No doubt in that. Isn't it? Yeah. Come on. 2, 4. And then next one. Go for next one.
Arrival
of Portuguese. Then answer must be 2, 4, 3, 1. Clear now? That's all. So simple. So simple. That's why even whenever we are starting the classes of history, in the beginning class itself, I used to incorporate all these nuances because that is important. What mode of questions were they are asking? Next. The king was freed from his people. What a wonderful statement here. Such a wonderful statement in history here. Yeah. I love this statement. Try to love the content. Try to love the subject here. The king was freed from his people and they from their king. On whose death did Bodoni? Bodoni. Who was Bodoni? He was a scholar. Who was Jiyauddin Birni? He was a scholar. Correct, I remember. He was a scholar. Who was Issami? He was a scholar. Please try to remember. Thereby, whenever you will go through, the king was freed from his people and they from their king. On whose death did Bodoni comment? Why Muhammad bin Tughlaq? Muhammad bin Tughlaq, he was a man of ideas but ill-starred idealist. Correct, I remember. Yeah, gulab to sundarai, magar gulshan mein kanta hai. Okay, he was a man of ideas, no doubt in that. But he was an ill-starred idealist. Okay, as soon as the death, based on the death, see, every death, it values person's personality. It values the significance of that respective person in the society. Based on that only, where he quoted, try to remember. Thereby, the answer must be Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Pakka, no doubt in that. Okay. Then, next we will move on to Indo-Islamic culture. Sipa, here it starts here. Yeah.
Here, the real content starts of your history.
Okay, with reference to the religious history of medieval India, the Sufi mystics were known to pursue which of the following practices?
Who are Sufis? The word Sufi is basically derived from?
See, whenever we will go through, see, in medieval Indian history, from competitive examination perspective, there are two important aspects. Try to remember. We will consider it as mystic movements of medieval period. Always emphasize on these two. Mystic movements of medieval period. When we emphasize on mystic movements of medieval period, under the purview of these mystic movements, there are two important mystic movements. Number one, Sufi movement and Bhakti movement. Correct, Pa? Sufi movement and Bhakti movement. Sufi movement and Bhakti movement. What is the fundamental difference between these two, Sufi movement and Bhakti movement? The Sufi movement, it was a mystic movement in Islam. Okay, try to remember. Against orthodox practices. Why they started mystic movement means, in order to put forward antagonism against orthodox practices. Okay, thereby the Sufis were unorthodox in nature. Are you getting my point? Sufis were unorthodox in nature. Then the Bhakti movement. Like Sufi movement only? Correct, I remember. Because the Hindu society, it was plagued by social evils. Or it was plagued by social stigmas. In order to ameliorate social evils from the Indian society, or to purify the nuances of Indian society, where they started a mystic movement in Hinduism, that is Bhakti movement. Correct, I remember. Bhakti movement. Because we have to purify. We have to purify our character. We have to purify our conduct. Correct, I remember. Then only where we can set the right forum or right stage in order to ameliorate. Please try to remember Sufi movement and Bhakti movement. The word Sufi is basically derived from the root word Sup. Correct? Try to remember. The word Sufi is basically derived from Sup. And one more thing you must remember. If you want, you can mention. According to Abul Fazl, just one sentence. According to Abul Fazl, there were 14 Sufi orders. According to Abul Fazl, there were 14 Sufi orders. 14 Sufi orders. According to Abul Fazl. The Sufi orders were known as what? They used to ask. Sufi orders were known as, they may give four choices. Okay, try to remember. What about Sufi orders? The Sufi orders were known as what? Jadon. Silsilas. The Sufi orders were known as silsilas. Don't forget, put it in inverted commas. The Sufi orders were known as silsilas. Silsilas. But examination point of view, they are always emphasizing on four important Sufi orders. Okay, four important Sufi orders per your kind information. Which are those four important Sufi orders means? Chisti, try to remember. And then the next one, Suharwardi. And then Qadri. And then Naqshbandi. See, these are important. Yeah, don't go through any other silsila except these four silsilas. See, among these four silsilas, where they are asking questions especially, confined to this Chisti, because it was a prominent silsila in India. Prominent silsila. Why it became prominent silsila means because it was patronized by different Mughal rulers. The Mughal rulers as well as the Delhi Sultanate rulers. Thereby the Chisti silsila, it enjoyed predominantly patronage of medieval rulers. Try to remember, it enjoyed predominant patronage of medieval rulers. Thereby try to emphasize on Chisti. This is very, very important. And they are asking one more important question based on one important concept. Contemporary. For example, Akbar, he was a contemporary of which Sufi saint? They are asking in the form of statements. Statements. Are you getting my point? Try to understand this. They are asking, if you go through Chisti, please try to remember, who was the first person who established Chisti Silsila? Khwaja Abdul Chisti in 966 at Iran. It was introduced in India by Mainuddin Chisti. Thereby, Mainuddin Chisti considered as first Sufi saint of India, where he settled at Ajmer. Correct, I remember. Who was responsible? The Muhammad Ghor, Prithviraj Chauhan and Muhammad Ghor, two battles of Tarain, 1191-1192. Correct, I remember. Even today, where this Ajmer, it has got so much of historical significance in terms of syncretic culture. Why? Because the Mainuddin Chisti, he was not only venerated by the Muslims, at the same time, he was also venerated by Hindus. Thereby, the Ajmer, it emerged as an hub of composite culture, or it's an hub of cultural assimilation. Try to remember, cultural assimilation. Thereby, try to go through it. But in Chisti, one more important person where they used to ask the questions. Hazrat Nizamuddin Awliya. Hazrat Nizamuddin Awliya. Try to remember, Hazrat Nizamuddin Awliya. 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 Nizamuddin Awliya. Where this Hazrat Nizamuddin Awliya, he was a teacher of, or he was a guru of Amir Khusru. So important. Yeah. Who was a guru of Amir Khusru? Nizamuddin Awliya. He was a teacher or he was a guru of Amir Khusru. Not only that, you must remember one more important point. Amir Khusru, contemporary of Nizamuddin Awliya. Jiyauddin Barni, the great scholar, he was a contemporary of Nizamuddin Awliya. Are you getting my point? Nizamuddin Awliya. If you take Qutub Minar, because Qutub Minar, it was re-nomenclatured on the basis of which Sufi saint? Muhammad Qutubuddin Bakhtiyar Kaki. Correct, I remember. Re-nomenclatured on the basis of a Sufi saint, Muhammad Qutubuddin Bakhtiyar Kaki. That's very, very important. Please try to go through it. And where this Nizamuddin Awliya, he was also called as Siddh. Why he was called as Siddh? Why he was called as Siddh? Because the Sufis, they were very much influenced by the practices of Hinduism. Try to remember, Hinduism, as well as the practices of Buddhists. Try to remember, the Sufi, it has got the influence of Hindu culture as well as the Buddhist culture. Is it not in Hindu culture where we can come across the concept of Siddh? Siddh means, we can interpret in two ways, the word Siddh. Siddh means the person who achieved pursuit of excellence. He was known as Siddh. Okay, Pandit we will call it as. Okay, Pandit we will call it as. But whenever we will go through Siddh, the Siddh associated with the practices pertaining to yoga, or the practices attributed to yoga, the person who specialized in breathing techniques. Because breath is a bridge between body and mind. Correct? I remember, according to nuances of yoga, where breath is a bridge between body and mind. When breath is a bridge between body and mind, the person who practiced the tools and techniques of pranayama, or breathing tools and techniques, he was popularly called as Siddh. What they have given here? Huh? What they have given here? The first statement. The meditation and control of breath. Correct? Are you getting my point? Yeah, that's why where I am explaining this. Try to remember. Yeah, without explanation, you cannot understand. Yeah. Okay. See, the faculty must fill the blood and flesh. Correct. Try to remember that liveliness. The faculty must be like 50,000 volts in a classroom. Then we can enthrall, we can influence the minds of our students. No doubt in that. Okay, severe ascetic exercises in lonely places. Definitely, ascetics. What was the meaning of asceticism or ascetics? Saints. Correct, I remember, saints. Okay, in Sufism, the saints are known as what? This is what here. Try to link the things here. Whenever you are going through any question or question paper means, try to link the things. linking. Aji is different. Aji means the person who visited Mecca. Whenever he returned, he was popularly called as Aji. Correct? Try to remember. Aji is a core principle associated with Islam. Whenever a Muslim he was born, till his last breath or prior to his last breath, what at least once he must visit to Mecca. Correct? I remember. Like in Hinduism, Kashi. Correct? What? I remember. Kashi. Severe ascetic exercises in a lonely place. Please try to remember. Kalandars. Try to go through this terminology. Kalandars. Kalandars. Okay? Kalandars. Please try to remember. Dervish is there. That is different. Dervish. The most backward, downtrodden community belong to Islamic arena. Recitation of holy songs to arouse a state of ecstasy in their audience. Because through their songs only, they conveyed the benevolent messages to the masses in order to bring the transformation in the society. Correct? I remember. But at that time, without enthusiasm, without gist, we cannot leave that influence on the part of the people. Correct? I remember. Or in the minds of the people. Thereby, see here, the recitation of holy songs to arouse a state of ecstasy in their audiences. Please try to remember, whatever the songs of Sufism, we will consider it as samas. Don't write samosa, samas. The samas means the songs. Try to remember, the songs attributed to Sufism. Samas. Samas. Saman is different. Samas is different. Try to understand this. Now, select the correct answer using the codes given below.
All three are correct.
Correct? Try to remember. The meditation and control of breath we can come across. Severe ascetic exercises. Recitation of holy songs to arouse. A state of ecstasy. All the three are correct. Please try to remember. Having perfect relevance. Try to go through Chisti, Suharwardi, and which are all the rulers, or who are all the rulers who followed each and every order, the Qadri order. But among four, which was the most conservative Sufi order? They may ask. Conservative. Which was the most conservative Sufi order? Naqshbandi. Where this Naqshbandi? The conservative in its approach. Conservative in approach. Who was a Sufi saint who followed conservative measures? Sir Ahmad Sirindi. Ahmad Sirindi. Right, remember. Ahmad Sirindi. Who followed, which Mughal ruler who followed this Naqshbandi order means, please try to remember, Aurangzeb. Because Ahmad Sirindi, he was a pro-Pauslatar, he was a pro-Jijiya. Thereby, Aurangzeb introduced a re-imposition of Jijiya in 1675. Is it clear? Try to remember. That is the reason. Thereby, and Qadri, who followed Qadri order? Which Mughal ruler followed Qadri order? Just you jot down, Amir. Pardon me, the Qadri order was followed by Dara Shikoh. Dara Shikoh. Try to remember, Dara Shikoh. And one more point I want to add in Naqshbandi. Babur was also patronized Naqshbandi order. But initially, it was liberal in its approach. Later on, after emergence of this Ahmad Sirindi, where they assimilated conservative measures. They followed conservative measures. But even Babur, he was also a follower of Naqshbandi order. Okay, try to remember. And then Chisti, Akbar. He was a contemporary of Salim Chisti. Try to remember. Salim Chisti. Where we can come across the tomb of Salim Chisti at Fatehpur Sikri. Correct? Try to remember. Is it clear now? Because Salim Chisti was a preceptor of Akbar. He was a preceptor of Akbar. Suharwardi. Who followed the Suharwardi means Iltumish. Iltumish, try to remember, Iltumish. See, these are all important. Is it clear? Then we will move on to, see, who among the following was the first bhakti saint to use Hindi for the propagation of his message? Because the Sufi movement as well as the bhakti movement mainly responsible for flourishment of vernacular languages. Okay, try to remember, development of vernacular languages. because without using the language of a common masses, they cannot convey their message to the masses. Correct? I remember. It must be simple, no?
Yeah.
What is the preparation means? As much as possible, we have to make our preparation so simple, based on our own interpretation. Correct? I remember. Thereby, who among the following was the first Bhakti saint to use Hindi for the propagation of his message? Dadu is there, Kabir is there, Ramananda is there, Tulsidas is there. All saints associated with Bhakti movement. Correct? I remember. But though they differed in their ideological setup, okay, try to remember, or ideological differences, try to remember. Why? Because in Bhakti movement, we can come across two important aspects. Bhakti movement, we can come across two important aspects. Nirguna and Saguna. Correct, pa? These are the two important aspects. Nirguna and Saguna. The name itself signifies Nirguna. What was the meaning of Nirguna? Nirguna, yaar. Guna means attribute, yaar. See, Guna means attribute. They didn't worship God in anthropomorphic form. They always believed in formless God. Try to remember, without any attributes. Suppose if you go through Saguna, where they mainly worshipped God in anthropomorphic form. Why? Because the Nirguna sect, it is always considered as non-sectarian. Correct? It was always considered as non-sectarian. Try to remember, non-sectarian. Whenever it is a non-sectarian means, where they mainly denounced, idol worship. Correct? I remember. They rejected idolatry. Try to understand. Thereby, where we can differentiate, we can distinguish, between this Nirguna as well as Saguna. What about Saguna? Where they mainly worshipped God in, not in abstract form, in anthropomorphic form. Please try to remember. Saguna. Then what about Dadu? Dadu Dayal. Where this Dadu Dayal, the famous Bhakti saint of western part of India. Dadu Dayal. Okay, try to remember. Which was an important movement started by Dadu Dayal? Anybody in this classroom? Which was an important movement started by Dadu Dayal in order to convey message? Dadu Dayal. Huh? Just you jot down, because it is important from prelims perspective. Nipak movement. Just in order to quell, try to remember, the worldly desires or worldly patterns. Nipak movement, the most liberal movement. Nipak, started by whom? Dadu Dayal. Please try to remember, Dadu Dayal. Then what about Kabir? Who was Kabir? Where this Kabir, popularly called as the great saint, popularly called as Karl Marx of India. Yeah, Kabir was popularly called as Karl Marx of India. Karl Marx of India. Oh Kabir, Sanskrit is like a language. Water in the well, whereas a language of common masses is like a flowing stream. Correct? Right? Remember, it's like a flowing stream. Who quoted it? Kabir quoted. Right? Remember, Kabir. Kabir was a contemporary of? Which Delhi Sultanate ruler? He was a contemporary of which Delhi Sultanate ruler? Kabir. Just if you want, you jot down Sikandar Lodi. Why Sikandar Lodi? Even Sikandar Lodi hatched the conspiracy to kill Kabir. Try to understand this. Okay? Yeah, where he hatched the conspiracy in order to kill Kabir. Why? In order to kill Kabir. Because Sikandar Lodi, he was blasphemist. Means religious fundamentalist. Okay, try to remember. He was a blasphemist. thereby where Kabir he mainly emphasized on Hindu Muslim unity. Okay, Kabir always emphasized on Hindu Muslim unity. Where we can come across tomb of Kabir? Ram Rahim Eki Ai. Correct, I remember. Where we used to call God by different names. Allah is only one. God is only one. Correct, I remember. Kabir. The followers of Kabir popularly called as Kabir Panthis. Correct, I remember. Followers of Kabir, we will consider it as Kabir Panthis. Where we can come across the Dargah or the tomb of Kabir, Magar. Magar. In detail where I can explain, because due to paucity of time I cannot, but I am emphasizing on the points which are having relevance with your preparation. Okay. And when you go through this Kabir, where this Kabir, he compiled couplets. Okay, couplets. Couplets means two lines, some couplets in order to convey message. Whenever you will go through these couplets, popularly called as Doha. Correct, right, remember. The couplets popularly called as Doha. Doha, please try to remember. Or we can also consider as Bichak. Doha or Bichak. Try to remember. Doha or Bichak. Kabir. He was a Nirguna saint or Saguna saint? Nirguna. The Kabir, he mainly belonged to Nirguna. Nirguna. But he was born to a widow of a Brahmin, for your kind information, Kabir. But he was brought by a poster father, especially belonged to Muslim community. Thereby, where this Kabir, he became Zulahi. What was the meaning of Zulahi? Hindi, Simran. Hindi, Zulahi. What does it mean? Okay, what was the meaning of Zulaha? Jula is different. Okay, what was the meaning of Bunkar? Bunkar. Oh. I want to learn Hindi from your side here. What is this? Come on. Zulaha. Zulaha means weaver. Weaver. Okay, weaver. He was a weaver by profession. Yeah, Kabir, I remember, but he was a disciple of the great personality Ramananda. Okay, I remember, Ramananda, he was a disciple of Ramananda. I remember, who was Ramananda? Here, we can come across Ramananda. Who was Ramananda? He was a disciple of Ramanujacharya. He was a disciple of Ramanujacharya. Then what was the significance of Ramananda? Whenever we will emphasize on the role of Ramananda or functional role of Ramananda, one must remember, if you want, you can jot down, Ramananda considered as connecting link between south and north in propagation of bhakti movement. Yeah, considered as a connecting link between north and south, or south and north, where for the first time the seeds of bhakti can be seen in South India, correct? I remember South India. Later on, it was propagated to Northern region. Okay, I remember Northern region, because whatever that roots mainly served as arteries of dissemination of our culture. Please try to remember. Thereby, Ramananda, he was a disciple of Ramanujacharya, where he propagated the nuances of bhakti in Northern region. Thereby, always considered a connecting link between North as well as South. Okay, Ramananda. The disciples of Ramananda, we will call Avadutas. Yeah, try to jot down this word, Avadutas. Avadutas, disciples. The disciples of Ramananda, 12 disciples of Ramananda. Sometimes they will ask for match the following. Later on, we will come across Avadutas. The followers of Ramananda, popularly called as Avadutas. Okay, try to remember, Avadutas. Then, Tulsidas. Who was Tulsidas? Contemporary of Akbar. Tulsidas, he was a contemporary of Akbar, where he wrote Ramacharitamanas. Okay, Ramacharitamanas. Please try to remember the Ramacharitamanas for the first time, where he translated it into Hindi. Okay, try to remember Hindi version of Ramayana. He was a contemporary of Akbar, Tulsidas. Then, whenever we will go through Ramananda, in order to convey the message or poetic expression for the first time, he used Hindi. Okay, who was the first person who used Hindi means Ramananda. Answer must be Ramananda. Is it clear? Dadu Dayal, Kabir and Tulsidas. Sipa, again, same question. Try to remember one way or the other way they used to ask. Okay, see, match list 1 with list 2 and select the correct answer using the course given below. Bhakti saints and profession. Okay, try to remember. Bhakti saint and profession. I already mentioned 12 disciples of Ramananda. Correct, try to remember. How we can recognize the 12 disciples of Ramananda means by their professions. Okay, try to remember, by their professions. Why their by their professions means, if you consider the Nirguna sect, most of the followers of Nirguna sect, they yield from lower rungs of the society, the downtrodden sections of the society. Correct, right? Remember, whenever they yield from downtrodden sections of the lower rungs of the society, grassroots level of the society, at that time you must match, right? Remember, with their names along with profession. Namdev, so easier. Namdev, he was tailor. Correct. Try to remember. Namdev, he was a tailor. Where we can come across? A3. This and this. Correct. Where we can eliminate? A and D we can easily eliminate. Correct. Or try to remember. Where we can eliminate? A3, tailor. And then Kabir. We have already discussed. Correct. Try to remember. Yeah. Kabir. Weaver. Correct. Try to remember. And then Ravidas. Suppose if they won't use the word cobbler, then what alternative word where they can substitute? This is what. Any Tom, Dick, Harry knows that cobbler. Yeah, an alternative word. Imagine the following. Come on, Jadon. Mochi. Mochi shoes, branded shoes. If you go to MG Road, where we can find a special shop for mochis. Correct, I remember. Yeah, mochi. Clear? Then, Ravidas, cobbler or mochi. Okay, I remember. And then Sena, barber. Correct, I remember. Barber. Is there any alternative word for barber? Is there any word? Think until per barber. Per barber. Okay, then which is the correct answer? Which is the correct answer? A, 3.
B, sir.
Correct. B. B, 2. Weaver. And then C, 4. Okay, cobbler. Sena, for example. Just you jot down other choices. Danna. Jot down. Suppose if they won't give. Danna. He was Jat peasant. Danna, he was a Jat peasant. Danna, Jat peasant. Please try to remember. Danna. Pipa. Not pupa, pipa. Okay, try to remember. Pipa. What about pipa? Jat princess. Jat princess. Prince. Jat prince. Don't write princess. Prince. Jat prince. Okay, Danna, Jat peasant. Pipa, Jat prince. Okay, clear? Try to remember. Other two, where you can go through it. Next, we will move on to. Consider the following bhakti saints. Who among the above was were preaching when the Lodhi dynasty fell and Babur took over? Lodhi dynasty fell and Babur took over. So easy. That's what I told. You must understand the gist of it. See, consider the following bhakti saints. saints. They are interpreting in different ways here. That is what, for every, from time to time, the UPSC, it is becoming so clever to eliminate the candidates from the play. You must be aware of it. You, at any circumstances, you must not be eliminated. You must be one among 10. Yeah. Come on. Dadu Dayal, we have already discussed where he propagated nuances of bhakti in northwestern India. Okay, try to remember. Then, what about Guru Nanak? What about Guru Nanak? Is it not he was also Nirguna saint? Like Kabir? Correct, I remember. Then what about the Guru Nanak pa? Come on. Anybody? Where Guru Nanak, the first Sikh Guru, okay, where we can come across 10 Sikh Gurus, he was the first Sikh Guru, belonged to Khatri family. Always try to remember Khatri family. What about the speciality of this Khatri family? A family of traders, a family of accountants. Okay, try to remember family of traders, a Khatri family, Guru Nanak. Because recently in news, where we celebrated 550th birth anniversary of Guru Nanak, they have constituted Kartarpur corridor. Correct, where Guru Nanak burned at Talwandi, correct, where it was popularly called as Nankana Sahib, Talwandi. Correct, Talwandi, Nankana Sahib. Please try to remember. Then, when you go through Guru Nanak, I will add one more important point. He was considered as contemporary of Babur. He was considered as contemporary of Babur. Always try to remember. Guru Nanak, he was considered as a contemporary of Babur. Don't forget. Contemporary of Babur. Then answer is there in this point. Answer is there. Answer is there here. Answer is there. That's all. That's why you must understand what to study, what not to study from UPSC perspective. Okay, Guru Nanak. Even once Babur met Guru Nanak, because where he imbibed the ideology in order to tour. In south he toured Sri Lanka, in west he toured Mecca and Medina. Correct, I remember he was a person who emphasized on purity of character and purity of conduct. Right, remember, if any individual want to change their lifestyle or life, one should always emphasize on sanctity. Correct, right, remember, sanctity, purity of character and purity of conduct for your kind information. That's one important thing. And which is one more important thing introduced by this Guru Nanak means interdining. Yeah, interdining. Thereby, he outrightly rejected the caste system. This is very, very important. Guru Nanak outrightly rejected caste system. Correct? I remember where he promoted interdining. Where this interdining, it was promoted in the form of Langar Khanas. Correct? Langar Khanas. The interdining was promoted through Langar Khanas. Try to understand. Langar Khanas. Why Langar Khana? Where this Langar Khana, it was considered as community kitchens. Irrespective of caste, irrespective of creed, irrespective of class. Correct, I remember. Thereby, the Langar Khana, that's very, very important. Guru Nanak. Then whenever he was a contemporary of Babur, see here, who among the above was were preaching when the Lodhi dynasty fell and Babur took over? Definitely Guru Nanak. Correct, I remember. Dadu Dayal we cannot come across. Okay, and then Tyagaraja we cannot come across. Who was Tyagaraja? A gem of Carnatic music. Gem of Carnatic music. He was integral part of Trinity. Tyagaraja, Shama Shastri, Muthuswami Dikshita. The Trinity of Carnatic music. Right, remember. Clear? Then, with the reference to the cultural history of medieval India, consider the following statements. See? With reference to the cultural history of medieval India, consider the following statements. the Siddhas or Sitars of Tamil region were monotheistic and condemned idolatry. And you must add one more important point. The Bhakti movement, all the Bhakti movements were monotheistic movements. Try to have this statement in your mind. All the Bhakti movement considered as monotheistic in nature. Okay, try to remember, monotheistic in nature. Siddhas or Sitars of Tamil region were monotheistic and condemned idolatry. Lingayas of Kannada region questioned the theory of rebirth and rejected the caste hierarchy. What about the correct statements? Both are correct. Wrong. Both are wrong. Second one wrong. Both are wrong. Siddhas of Tamil region were monotheistic and condemned idolatry. Try to remember. Lingayas of Kannada region questioned the theory of rebirth and rejected the caste hierarchy. Shaiva movement. Correct, I remember. There are two kinds of Shaiva movements. Extreme Shaiva movement, moderate Shaiva movement. For example, if you go through Kapalika. Kapalika, it always signifies the extreme aspect. For example, Agoris. Correct? Agoris. Kapalika or Agoris. Extreme Shaivism we can come across, isn't it? Try to understand. Even today we can come across Agoris in northern region. Come on. The Siddhas or Sitars of Tamil region were monotheistic and condemned idolatry. Lingayas of Kannada region questioned the theory of rebirth and rejected the caste hierarchy. Definitely, even they rejected untouchability practices. Correct? The best personality, Basavanna. Correct? Try to remember. Basavanna. Thereby, is it one only? Is it two only? Both one and two only? Neither one nor two. Both one and two. I will put one question mark. Try to go through it properly. Yeah, try to go through it properly. Next. Among the following, who was not proponent of Bhakti cult? Among the following, who was not proponent of Bhakti cult? Try to remember. See here, whenever you will go through the Nagarjuna, what about Nagarjuna? Where Nagarjuna, Buddhist scholar, correct? Try to remember, Buddhist scholar, he was responsible for Madhyamika school of philosophy, correct? He was responsible for Madhyamika school of philosophy, correct? Try to remember, where Nagarjuna never associated with the concept of Bhakti. He was not at all a proponent belong to Bhakti concept or Bhakti cult. Correct, I remember. Then Tukaram. What about role of Tukaram? Role of Tukaram. Jnandev, Eknath, Tukaram. Correct, I remember. Tulsidas, Namdev, Tukaram. Tukaram. What about Tukaram? Where this Tukaram started an important movement known as Varkari movement. Okay, try to remember. Varkari movement. Varkari movement. Then who started Dharkari movement? Varkari movement. Where this Varkari movement, it was always considered as a Vitoba cult. Okay, Vitoba cult, Maharashtra. Try to remember, Maharashtra. Vitoba cult. Even today we can come across Pandharpur. Correct? Try to remember, Pandharpur. Dharkari movement by Samarth Ramdas. Samarth Ramdas. Samarth Ramdas. Forget me a point. Samarth Ramdas. Where this Samarth Ramdas compiled an important literary source called as Dasabodha. This is important from prelims perspective. Dasabodha. Please try to remember. Dasabodha. Dasabodha. Okay, clear? Try to understand. Then Tyagaraja, a gem of Carnatic music. Okay, try to remember. Then Vallabhacharya. Who was Vallabhacharya? who was Vallabhacharya, where he belonged to a Telugu Brahmin family. Okay, try to remember. Where this Vallabhacharya, please try to remember, he propounded, he was a great proponent of Jadum, Pushti Marga. This is important. Where this Vallabhacharya, he was a great proponent of Pushti Marga. Pushti Marga means the path of grace. Okay, path of grace. Where this path of grace responsible for attaining salvation. Okay, attaining salvation. Pushti Marga, Vallabhacharya. Vallabhacharya. Is it clear?
Yes.
I have written.
Yes.
Next we will move on to Bhakti Tukaram was a contemporary of which Mughal ruler?
Jahangir.
Okay, here, try to remember. He was a contemporary of which Mughal ruler means? Jahangir. Please try to remember. Jahangir. Then what about Babar? Who was a contemporary of Babar?
Guru
Nanak. Is it only Guru Nanak? Just you jot down one more point. See Krishna Devaraya. That's all here. Yeah. Don't be stereotyped. You must add points. See Krishna Devaraya was also considered as a contemporary of Babar. Okay, where we can come across? Tujiki Baburi. Try to remember where he was popularly called as Kafir. Correct. He was popularly called as Kafir. Try to remember. Kafir. Sri Krishna Devaraya. Then Akbar. Who was a contemporary of Akbar? Salim Chisti. He was a contemporary of Akbar. And then one more important name I want to add. Guru Ramdas. Guru Ramdas. The fourth Sikh Guru. Guru Ramdas, he was a fourth Sikh Guru. Please try to remember. Fourth Sikh Guru. Guru Ramdas. Why? Why he must be considered as a contemporary? Why? Because Akbar for the first time he granted land to build or to construct Armandir. Where for Ramdas, Akbar granted land to construct Armandir. Popularly called as Golden Temple. Okay, try to remember. Popularly called as Golden Temple. Please try to remember. Akbar, Guru Ramdas, and then Tulsidas. Try to remember. And then Salim Chisti. Jahangir. Who was a contemporary of Jahangir? Tukaram, he was a contemporary. No doubt in that. One more name is there. Jadung. Guru Argovind. Guru Argovind. Because where he led the Sikh revolt against Jahangir. Why? Because Jahangir was responsible for death of fifth Sikh Guru, Guru Arjun Dev. Correct? Right? Remember? Guru Arjun Dev. Where Guru Arjun Dev, he became political rivalry of whom? Jahangir. Right? Remember? Yeah, where it was ended in the assassination of the fifth Sikh Guru, Guru Arjun Dev. Please try to remember. And then Aurangzeb. Please try to remember. Aurangzeb. Is there any contemporary with regard to Aurangzeb? Yeah. Tej Bahadur. Guru Tej Bahadur. The ninth Sikh Guru. Okay. Guru Tej Bahadur, ninth Sikh Guru. Please try to remember. Okay. Is it clear? Then next we will move on to. The answer must be Jahangir. Next we will move on to consider the following statements. Saint Nimbaraka was a contemporary of Akbar. No. Correct? Try to remember. There itself we can reject it. Saint Kabir, whenever the statement number one, where we can come across statement number one, here we can come across. Here we can come across, and then what about statement two? Saint Nimbaraka was a contemporary of Akbar. Saint Kabir was greatly influenced by Sheikh Ahmad Sirindi. Why Sheikh Ahmad Sirindi? He was conservative. When Sheikh Ahmad Sirindi was a conservative, means because he basically belonged to Nakasbandi order. Correct? I remember. Whenever he was a conservative, means never Saint Kabir was influenced. Correct? I remember. Why? He basically belonged to a non-sectarian congregation, Nirguna. Correct? I remember. Where he mainly emphasized on Hindu-Muslim unity. What about Sheikh Ahmad Sirindi? He was a pro-co-slaughter, and then the second important concept, pro-jejiya concept. Try to remember, thereby, neither one nor two. Okay, neither one nor two, because both the statements are wrong statements. Thereby, answer must be neither one nor two. Hey, one must be very careful here. While opting for neither one nor two, please try to remember. Because UPSC people know, earlier they used to ask assertion and reason. Now it has been changed to neither one nor two. Anyway, examination is nearing, no? Don't worry, what is there in that? The first writer to use Urdu as the medium of poetic expression. What an easy question here. Easy question here. Where it requires 2 to 3 seconds to think. Okay? Answer? Amir Khusro. Try to remember, answer Amir Khusro. But what about Amir Khusro? You must learn with regard to Amir Khusro. Who was Amir Khusro? Yeah, he was a Persian poet. Not only he was a Persian poet, he was popularly called as father of Qawwali. Who was Amir Khusro? He was popularly called as father of Qawwali. Father of Qawwali. And not only he was a father of Qawwali, where he earned a title Toti Ind, for your kind information, or Indian parrot. Okay, it was conferred on Amir Khusro by Alauddin Khilji, where he nearly represented 8 Delhi Sultanates. Okay, 8 important Delhi Sultanates, for your kind information. Father of Qawwali. Not only he was father of Qawwali, at the same time, he also introduced new ragas. He also introduced new ragas. Please try to remember, new ragas. Which are those? Suppose they may ask, Ayman, Sanam, Gora, Tappa, Thumri. Ayman, Sanam, Gora, Ayman, Sanam, Gora, Tappa, Thumri. See, these are some of the important ragas by whom? Amir Khusro, the great musician. Right, remember, he was a great musician, and he also introduced a musical instrument, sitar. Who invented sitar? Amir Khusro only. Please try to remember. Amir Khusro only. Sitar. The father of Qawwali, new ragas, Ayman, Sanam, Gora, Tappa and Thumri. Sitar. He was a great musician. Then Mirza Ghalib. Who was Mirza Ghalib? Mirza Ghalib considered as father of ghazals. Who was Mirza Ghalib? He was considered as father of ghazals. Try to remember. Mirza Ghalib. He was considered as father of ghazals. Try to understand. Bahadur Shah Zafar, the last recognized ruler of Mughals. Correct? I remember. Bahadur Shah Zafar, the last recognized ruler of Mughals. And the fees, no much relevance here. Okay, clear? Try to emphasize on Amir Khusrupa, because several times they asked in culture. That's why here they may had cultural history of medieval India. Okay, and Amir Khusro, just you jot down one more point, personification of composite culture. Amir Khusro, he was a personification of composite culture. Try to remember. What was an important statement made by Amir Khusro? There was an important statement. Every pearl in a royal crown is a crystallized form of tears fallen from the eyes of the peasants. Correct? I remember. A wonderful statement made by Amir Khusro, isn't it? Next, Vijayanagara Empire. Okay, who of the following founded a new city on the south bank of a tributary to River Krishna and undertook to rule his new kingdom as the agent of deity to whom all the land south of the river Krishna was supposed to belong? See the question here, the conceptual type of question, but answer is so simple. Akka and Bukka, correct? I remember. Akka and Bukka, where they have founded a mighty dynasty on the banks of River Tungabhadra. Okay, try to remember, on the banks of River Tungabhadra. Amoghavarsha 1. Who was Amoghavarsha? Amogha Varsha, he was Rashtrakuta ruler. Correct? I remember. He was a staunch Jain. Where this Amogha Varsha one, he was a staunch Jain. He mainly patronized Jainism. Please try to remember. And then Ballala II. Who was Ballala II? He was a ruler of Vaisalas. Ballala II, he was a ruler of Vaisalas, for your kind information. And then Ariyara one, the founder. Here itself where you can come across. Okay. Earlier they mainly served in the court of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Where that Muhammad bin Tughlaq rule set the stage for fundamental foundation of Vijayanagara Empire as well as the Bahumani Empire. Correct, I remember. Even the Bahumani founder, he also served under the patronage of or during the rule of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Prataparudra II. Who was Prataparudra II?
Kakatiya.
Yeah, Kakatiya. Please try to remember. He was a Kakatiya ruler. Try to remember. Gajapati Prataparudra is different. Try to remember. Orissa. Okay, try to remember. Here Prataparudra II, Kakatiyas. Even we can come across a queen by name Rudramma Devi. Correct? Try to remember. The Rudramma Devi. Is it clear? Then what about answer? C. Ariyara 1. Next we will move on to one more. Ready, Dira? Okay. Regarding taxation system of Krishna Deva, the ruler of Vijayanagara, consider the following statements. See, first and foremost aspect you must consolidate here. What they asked? Taxation system of Krishna Deva. Which inscription? It gives detailed description of the taxation implemented by Sri Krishna Deva. Yeah, where he mentioned about the taxation system or the tax, it was imposed on 59 items. Because without taxation, can we imagine replenishment of resources or resource consolidation? No. Can we imagine administrative machinery without consolidation of taxes or the tax collections? Come on. Regarding taxation system, Jadum, just only one point, Kondavidu inscription. Kondavidu inscription. Yeah, that's all. There is the matter. Kondavidu inscription, it exclusively deals with taxation system attributed to the rule of Sri Krishna Devaraya. Okay, attributed to the rule of Sri Krishna Devaraya. Kondavidu inscription. Where he mentioned about the 59 items, on 59 items where they mainly imposed the taxes, for your kind information. Okay. And he also abolished Sita Sunka. Sita Sunka. He abolished Sita Sunka. The tax on marriage. Sita Sunka. Okay. Please try to remember. See, the first statement, the tax rate on land was fixed depending on the quality of the land. Correct? Try to remember, quality of land. See, without fertility, where we cannot expect the quantum of yield or quantum of production. Correct? Try to remember. Then the private owners of workshops paid on industries tax. Yes. Correct? Try to remember. Is it both the statements are correct?
Yes.
Both the statements are correct. Both 1 and 2 are correct. See, whenever you will go through the private owners of workshops, see here, in history we can come across an important concept called as guild system. Correct? Try to remember, guild system we can come across. When we go through guild system, suppose, what was the meaning of manigrama? Okay, what was the meaning of Shreni? What was the meaning of Nana Deshi? Manigrama means an association of merchants, an association of guilds of South India. Try to remember, an association of merchants of South India, Manigrama. Please try to remember. The best example I can give you, Malabar Coast. Try to remember, Nana Deshi means the merchants or the guilds who hailed from different destinations in the world. That's why the concept, the theme itself signifies Nana Deshi. Okay, Sheni means an association of merchants or the guilds belong to northern region. Okay, try to remember. For example, Gujarat coast. Yeah, an association of merchants belong to northern region or the guilds, what we will call. For example, during ancient period, we can come across an important guild by name Sadalaputta, where he nearly owned the entire the pottery concept. Sadalaputta, try to remember. Try to go through it. Clear? Then next we will move on to one more important question. Which of the following Muslim rulers was hailed as Jagadguru by subject because of his belief in secularism? Even today it has got so much of relevance, because where we are facing in modern society, we are facing sectarian strife. Correct? In modern society where we are facing sectarian strife. When we are facing sectarian strife or intolerance, where we must emphasize on credentials of secularism. Correct? I remember, without emphasizing on credentials of secularism, we cannot ensure the moral fabric or the moral fabric of social philosophy, that is non-violence and tolerance, in order to ensure communal harmony on the part of our society. Correct? I remember, thereby, during Bahumani rule as well as Vijayanagara rule, for example, can you give an example of a Vijayanagara ruler who purely followed the path of secularism? Anybody? Yeah, just you jot down Devaraya II or Prouda Devaraya. Correct, I remember. Prouda Devaraya, where he followed the path of secularism. Correct, I remember. I want to give one more important concept here. Sullikul. Try to understand this. Sullikul. Who incorporated the theme of Sullikul in administration? Where it mainly propounded the theme of secular administration. Correct? I remember. The Sullikul concept, it was imbibed by Akbar. Correct? Try to remember. Akbar. Then, the third rock edict of Ashoka, what it basically deals with? The secular policy of Ashoka. Correct? I remember. Secular policy of Ashoka. This is what the holistic approach in your preparation. Yeah. If you come across anything. See here. Just he asked with regard to Jagadguru, the theme secularism. Correct? Huh? Whenever you will go through secularism, you must remember all these important concepts. Okay? Devaraya II, he also followed the path of secularism in order to ameliorate sectarian strife in this society. Please try to remember. And Akbar followed Sullikul, and the peace to all. Try to remember. Sullikul. And then the third rock edict of Ashoka, it also deals with nuances of secularism, where he accorded equal importance to each and every section of the society, based on the concept of tolerance. Hushyant Shah, so he was also a ruler. Jainul Abidin. Yeah, this is very, very important. Jainul Abidin. Who was Jainul Abidin? Who was Jainul Abidin? Just you jot down. Akbar of Kashmir. Who was Jainul Abidin? The Jainul Abidin was popularly called as Akbar of Kashmir. Akbar of Kashmir. Try to remember. Akbar of Kashmir. Jainul Abidin. Where this Jainul Abidin quote? Jainul Abidin quote was adorned by the great scholar Jonaraj. If you want, you can mention where his quote was adorned by the great scholar Jonaraj. Who was this Jonaraj? See, when Kallana, after the death of Kallana, the continuity of Raja Tarangini by Jonaraj. After the death of Jonaraj, who continued the writings of this Raja Tarangini? Srivara. Try to remember three important names with regard to Raja Tarangini. The first name, Kallana, the best text on historiography, and followed by Jonaraj and Srivara. Okay, try to remember all the three names. All the three names. Jainul Abidin and the first Muslim ruler who convened Amarnath Yatra. First Muslim ruler who convened Amarnath Yatra. Try to remember Amarnath Yatra. Here, then who was Akbar of Kashmir? Jainul Abidin. Yeah, try to remember. He was so famous for construction of Hindu temples, renovation of Hindu temples. During his rule, there were nearly 150 Hindu temples during the rule of Jainul Abidin. Okay, Ibrahim Adil Shah. Who was Ibrahim Adil Shah? He was a famous ruler of Adil Shahis. Okay, he was a famous ruler of Adil Shahis. Please try to remember Adil Shahis. Where Ibrahim Adil Shah? One or two? Ibrahim Adil Shah too. That is important. Always try to remember. Suppose if you go through, please try to remember Prithviraj Chauhan, poor Prithviraj Chauhan's we can come across. Correct? Try to remember. Thereby, Ibrahim Adil Shah too, where he was popularly called as Jagadguru. He was popularly called as Jagadguru. And he wrote Kitab-e-Nawras. He wrote an important text known as Kitab-e-Nawras. Kitab-e-Nawras. Try to remember where his subjects respected him like anything for your kind information. Muhammad II, he was also ruler of Bahmanis. Next, the Mughals. With reference to Mughal India, what are the differences between Jagirdar and Jamindar? Means which one of the following statements are correct? With reference to Mughal India, what are the differences between Jagirdar and Jamindar? Okay. The Jagirdars were holders of land assignments in lieu of judicial and police duties, whereas Jamindars were holders of revenue rights without obligation to perform any duty other than revenue collection. Land assignment to Jagirdars were hereditary and revenue rights of Jamindars were not hereditary. First is wrong. What about second here? Both are wrong only. Try to remember. Can we come across judicial and police duties? No, try to remember. Correct, try to remember. Even we studied Mansabdari system introduced by Akbar. Correct, try to remember. The military administration of Akbar. Try to understand. All Jagirdars were Mansabdars, but all Mansabdars were not Jagirdars. Correct, Pa? We have already studied in detail. Thereby, see here, it will never have any sort of relevance, whatever the statements they have given. Try to remember. Here we can come across we cannot come across judicial or police duties. Okay, please try to remember. We can come across the civil duties where they performed. Thereby, neither one nor two. Okay, no? Neither one nor two. This is so important. Who among the following Mughal emperors shifted emphasis from illustrated manuscripts to album and individual portrait? We have already discussed. Yeah, individual portrait. That individual portrait is also known as what? There are two kinds of the painting modes introduced by Jahangir. One was known as portrait painting and another was known as one was known as portrait painting.
What is this?
That too we have dealt in such a detailed way here. In such a detailed way where just we discussed. Correct? Fresco and portrait. What about fresco? Drawing floral designs on the walls. Correct? I remember. Then, who was a great painter who adorned the court of Jahangir? Who was a great painter who adorned the court of Jahangir? Because the Mughals responsible for an important concept called as Karkana. Correct? I remember. Karkana. Karkana means an imperial establishment. Okay, Karkana means an imperial establishment. Please try to remember, an imperial establishment. Whatever the goods and services required to a royal family were that goods and services produced in the arena of Karkana. Correct, try to remember. Or it's an important domain of goods and services for your kind information. Not only an imperial establishment. Who was a great painter? Where he adorned a title known as Shirin-i-Kalam. Where he adorned a title known as Shirin-i-Kalam. Shirin-i-Kalam. Anybody here? Anybody? Those who studied history in a systematic way. That is important, no? Systematic way. Shirin-i-Kalam. He was popularly known as Mian Mansur. Where he adorned a title known as Mian. Mian. Right, remember? Mian Mansur. Where this Mian Mansur, he was popularly called as Rappel of the East. He was popularly called as Rappel of the East. Clear? I remember Mian Mansur, he was popularly called as Rappel of the East. Who was the Rappel? A gem of a Trinity, Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo. Correct? I remember. Of Italy. Correct? I remember. Three important gems in the field of paintings. Mian Mansur. Then, Humayun. He didn't accorded much importance to paintings. Correct? Because where he faced or he has undergone exile phase. Correct? And try to remember. Then, Akbar. Definitely. Akbar, he was a real founder. Try to remember. A real brainchild behind Mughal paintings. Try to remember, he was the first Mughal ruler who started the concept of Karkana, where his Karkana was adorned by more than 103 painters. 103 painters. For example, Sayyid Tabriz. Sayyid Tabriz. Correct. Or Abdus Samad. Correct. Abdus Samad. The renowned painters who adorned the court of Akbar. Sayyid Tabriz and Abdus Samad. Where this Abdus Samad, he was also called as Mint Master of Akbar. Correct? Not only he was so familiar with the paintings, especially the mural paintings, he was also a mint master who headed minting department during the rule of Akbar. Okay, Abdus Samad. Abdus Samad, Humayun, Akbar. That's why even he quoted a few sentences. The person who ate paintings, I will always dislike him. Correct? I remember the person who ate paintings, I will always dislike him. Try to understand this. By whom? Statement made by Akbar. Then the Jahangir was popularly known as what? Jadum. The Jahangir, he was popularly called as the Prince of Artists. Correct? Jahangir was popularly called as Prince of Artists. I remember he was popularly called as Prince of Artists. Thereby, The Jahangir, he was called as father of Mughal painting. He was popularly called as father of Mughal paintings. Clear? Father of Mughal paintings. Please try to remember. He was popularly called as father of Mughal paintings. Is it clear? Then, is it Shah Jahan provided any impetus for paintings? No. Try to remember. With reference to Mian Tansen, which one of the following statements is not correct? See, with reference to Mian Tansen, which one of the following statements is not correct? Who was Mian Tansen? Huh? Who was Mian Tansen? Who was Tansen? Who was Tansen? What was the original name of Tansen? Ravi, what was the original name of Tansen? For example, original name of Birbal Mahesh Das. Correct, what? Try to remember. Then what was the original name of Tansen? Ram Tanu Pandey. The original name of Tansen, Ram Tanu Pandey. Clear, part? Try to remember. The original name of Tansen, Ram Tanu Pandey. Mian Tansen. Mian Tansen, great musician. Great musician. Adorned the court of Akbar. Correct? Great musician who adorned the court of Akbar. But who was a guru of Mian Tansen means Swami Haridas. Correct? Swami Haridas. Swami Haridas. Was a guru of Ram Tanu Pandey means Swami Haridas. Swami Haridas. Where this Tansen, he was responsible for several ragas. Correct? I remember. Mian Ki Todi, Darbari. Correct? I remember. Darbari, Megha Mallara. These are some of the important ragas invented by or incorporated by Tansen. Okay? Even he was also a product of Gwalior School of Music. Try to remember, Gwalior School of Music. Okay. Tansen was the title given to him by Emperor Akbar. Now, Tansen composed Drupads and Hindu gods and goddesses. Correct? Try to remember, Drupad. What about Drupad? What about Drupad? The oldest tradition of Hindustani music. If you ascertain the music of India, there are two basic streams of Indian music, Carnatic music and then Hindustani music. Thereby, which was the oldest Hindustani musical mode means the Drupad. Try to remember, Drupads. Now, who reinvented the Drupad styles means, if you want, you can mention Gundecha brothers. Gundecha brothers, Ramakant Gundecha, Umakant Gundecha. Okay, try to remember where they rejuvenated the Drupad music. Please try to remember Drupad, Tumri, Khayal, Tappa. Okay, these are four important nuances of Hindustani music. Then Tansen composed. Tansen composed songs on his patterns, definitely. And then Tansen invented many ragas. Correct? Try to remember. Then which is not having relevance? First one. Okay, try to remember. First one. Now you must find out. Tansen, Ram Tanu Pandey, Tansen, Swami Haridas. Next we will move on to one more important question. Oh, okay. Ibadat Khana at Fatehpur Sikri was. Oh, so easy. Ibadat Khana. What about Ibadat Khana? First, see, Ibadat Khana, we have already discussed for your kind information. Ibadat Khana, it was considered as a parliament of religions. Correct, Paul? Right, remember, parliament of religions. Ibadat Khana. Where this Ibadat Khana? 1575 AD. It was considered as a secular monument of Akbar's reign. Okay, it was a secular monument of Akbar Sreen. Correct? I remember. It was a secular monument of Akbar Sreen. Then the mask for the use of royal family. No, not at all. Try to remember. Akbar's private prayer chamber. No. The hall in which Akbar held discussions with the scholars of various religions. Okay, try to remember. The hall in which Akbar held discussions with scholars of various religions. Please try to remember. See here, what is the difference between this hall and room? See here, only one word difference here. Try to understand. Even so many aspirants, they may also opted for the fourth one. See the difference? The room in which the nobles belonging to different religious gatherings gather to discuss religious affairs. Correct? I remember. Religious affairs. But sometimes the UPSC people know. Eclectical affairs. The religious affairs were known as what? Eclectical. Try to remember. They may incorporate these words. Okay? Try to understand this. Eclectical. It is not room. It is an hall. Ibadat Khana. It's a secular monument constituted or established in order to convene the religious, in order to deliberate the religious aspects. Okay? Please try to remember. Where he incorporated Deen E Ilahi, correct? Based on the discussions, integrated discussions, isn't it? Next, the loss of Kandahar was a big blow to the Mughal Empire from the viewpoint of, see, in the advent of Mughals, Kabul and Kandahar became integral part. Correct, right, remember. Not only integral part, whenever you will go through this Kabul and Kandahar, please try to remember, one must remember strategic significance. Where it has got strategic significance. Correct, right, remember. Strategic significance. Then the loss of Kandahar was a big blow to the Mughal Empire from the viewpoint. Natural resources. No, try to remember. Buffer territory. Buffer means a small geographical region in between two large geographical areas. Correct, I remember. Communication. No, I remember. Strategic stronghold. The correct answer, please try to remember. Correct answer, strategic stronghold. It was lost during the rule of Shah Jahan. Try to understand. Next, we will move on to culture, paintings. Sipa, the well-known painting Bani Tani belongs to the Bani Tani. Okay, Bani Tani paintings. For example, Bundi school, where we can come across this Bundi school. Bundi, Rajasthan school of painting. Jaipur school, again it's a Rajasthan school of painting. And then Kangra, sub-Himalayan region. It belonged to sub-Himalayan region, especially Himachal Pradesh. Okay, try to remember, Himachal Pradesh, Kangra, Kulu, correct? Manali, isn't it? Kangra school, Kishangarh, try to remember. The correct choice with regard to the Bani Tani paintings, Kishangarh. But whenever you will go through this, the Rajasthani school of paintings, I already mentioned Ragamala paintings. Correct, I remember. Even they also derived the sources from the mythology, the Ramayana as well as Mahabharata. Okay, Ramayana as well as Mahabharata. The painting of Bodhisattva Padmapani is one of the most famous and often illustrated painting at Ajanta. Please try to remember. Which cave of Ajanta? Cave number 1. During the rule of cave number 1, cave number 2, cave number 16, 17 and 29. These caves mainly belong to the Guptas. Correct, I remember. Even Padmapani painting, it was compared to the paintings of Renaissance Correct? Try to remember. Paintings of Renaissance, Padmapani. Who was Padmapani? Bodhisattva. Okay, try to remember. And then Badami. What about Badami? Badami is famous for caves. Where? In Karnataka. Okay, try to remember. Built by whom? Mangalesha. Okay, try to remember. Four caves associated with three different the religious aspects. Shaivism, Vaishnavism and then Jainism. Bagh. What about Bagh? Where this Bagh as well as Ajanta, these are the two important places, yields the evidence for Gupta paintings. Okay, try to remember. Bagh. And then Ellora. What about Ellora? Rashtrakutas. Okay, try to remember. It also represents the composite culture. For your kind information, Ellora, it represents composite culture. Then who was an important king who was responsible for the biggest temple, means Krishna. One, he was a Rashtrakuta ruler. Okay, he was a Rashtrakuta ruler. Please try to remember. There are only two known examples of cave. See here, again the question. There are only two known examples of cave paintings of Gupta period in ancient India. One of these paintings of Ajanta caves. Where is the other surviving example of Gupta paintings? Yeah, just now we have discussed here. See, this is what where one must establish the link. Okay, the Lomesh Rishi cave. The Lomesh Rishi cave is a part of. Lomesh Rishi cave is a part of Ellora caves we can come across, Bagh caves we can come across. Lomesh Rishi cave, one of the a renowned cave, Barbara, try to remember, Barbara, who constituted Barbara caves? Mauryans, try to remember, Mauryans. Lomesh Rishi, Chauparnika, correct, try to remember, that Sudama, isn't it? Nasi caves. Where this Nasi caves? It has got relevance with Shatavanas. Yeah. Nasi caves. Kaneri caves. We can also come across Kaneri caves. We can also come across Junar caves. Okay. Try to remember Kaneri caves, Junar caves. Consider the following historical places. Oh, fine. Again, Ajanta caves. Okay. What about the sarbiquit of Ajanta caves? The Ajanta caves, please try to remember, Athens of Asia. Ajanta caves always considered Athens of Asia. Don't forget. Athens of Asia. Then, the next important one, Lepakshi temple. Lepakshi. Where Lepakshi? Andhra Pradesh. Yeah, definitely Lepakshi, Ajanta of Shaivism. Ajanta of Shaivism, an abode of Shaivism. Lepakshi was popularly called as Ajanta of Shaivism. Please try to remember Ajanta, Ajanta of Shaivism. But Lepakshi is so famous for mural paintings. Lepakshi is so famous for mural paintings. Where this Lepakshi temple, it was built during Nayaka period. This is very, very important. Nayaka period. It was built during Nayaka period. Please try to remember Lepakshi temple. But where this Lepakshi temple, it also signifies the modern tools and techniques of Indian attire. Just you jot down this point. The Lepakshi, it signifies tools and techniques of modern attire. Tools and techniques of modern attire. Try to remember. Tools and techniques of modern attire. Lepakshi temple. Where this Lepakshi, it was also responsible for or familiar for monolithic Nandi statue. The biggest monolithic statue. Correct? Try to remember. Lepakshi, Anantpur district. Okay, Anantpur district. Which was an important temple of Lepakshi? Veerabhadra Swami temple. Okay, That is important. Veerabhadra Swami Temple. Veerabhadra Swami Temple. And one more place is there. Thadapathri. Thadapathri. What about Thadapathri? See, these are all places belong to the rule of Vijayanagara empires. Correct? I remember. Thadapathri. Thadapathri Chintala Venkateshwara Swami Temple. At Thadapathri. Chintala Venkateshwara Swami Temple. Chintala Venkateshwara Swami Temple. Please try to remember. Chintala Venkateshwara Swami Temple. Also built by the Nayaks. It is in Anantapur district. Please try to remember. Okay. Thadapathri. And what was one more speciality of this temple means, here we can come across the sculpture where the sculpture influenced by the Vaisala art and architecture. Vaisala art and architecture. Okay, Vaisala art and architecture. And then Sanchi Stupa. Sanchi. What about Sanchi Stupa? Where? Madhya Pradesh. Okay, even it was included in UNESCO World Heritage List. Correct? Sanchi Stupa. Please try to remember. Then which one of the following places is also known for mural paintings? 1 and 2. Correct? Yeah, because at Sanchi Stupa we cannot come across. What about Sanchi Stupa? Here we can come across the Jatakas. Correct? Try to remember. It's a source of Buddhist art and architecture. Try to remember. Jatakas. It is a source of Buddhist art and architecture because in stupas we can come across gateways. Correct? Gateways mainly depict the events associated with life of Buddha. Okay, try to remember the paintings associated with life of Buddha. Thereby the Sanchi Stupa, try to go through it. The Mughal school of painting formed the spinal column. See here, spinal column. Without spinal column or spinal cord, can we live? The mobility, it will become null and void. Mobility will become null and void. Correct? Try to remember, it will become null and void. Why? It is like an highway. It is like an highway where that highway, it consists of the 31 peripheral routes for the transmission. Pahari. The Mughal school of painting formed the spinal column of different schools of Indian miniature art. Which one of the following painting styles was not affected by Mughal painting? Yeah, see here, Pahari, Rajasthani. Actually, where this Rajasthani paintings emerged due to the end of power mantle of the Mughals. Try to remember, especially after the rule of Aurangzeb. Try to remember where they migrated to the different regions. Okay, they settled and that in turn responsible for emergence of Rajasthani school of paintings. We already discussed, okay. And Kangra and Rajasthani, Kaligata. Yeah, try to remember, Kaligata paintings, Pahari. I think all of you know, we have already discussed. Try to go through it. Okay, next we will move on to one more question. Just we will end today's session. The Mughal painting reached its zenith. They must not ask this type of questions here. Where the students must have 360 degree approach while answering the question. Right, remember, they must ask that type of questions here, not so simple questions here. Mughal painting reached its zenith. Zenith means? Why you are using only word peak here? Correct. Final culmination. That's all. What is there in that? Correct. Try to remember. Or we will call it as the period of maturity. The period of maturity. Where this period of maturity we will call it as trans. The formative we will call it as cis. That's all here. There is the matter. English only, no? Humayun. Try to understand. Whenever we will go through Humayun, it didn't made any contribution, but Akbar made substantial contribution. But who constituted a special niche? In Mughal paintings means the Akbar or Jahangir. Jahangir constituted special niche. Why he constituted special niche means he was responsible for the transition phase of Mughal painting. Who was responsible? Jahangir was responsible for the transitional phase. Right, remember. But Shahjahan, no. He, where the Shahjahan rule, it was a rule of beggars and barbarians. Okay? Where we can come across the paintings here? No way. And one more concept I must introduce. What are Murakis? Murakis? Who was the benevolent son of Shahjahan?
Darashikoh.
Correct. Is it not Darashikoh personality where we must remember, we must consolidate with regard to Darashikoh? Why? He was a personification of composite culture. He was a geographer. He was a Vedantist. Correct? I remember. He mainly emphasized on Hindu-Muslim unity. Isn't it? What about Murakis? What are Murakis? For example, the term Muraki denotes, they will give four choices for. What about your fate? What about your fate for illumination? Oh, super here. Huh? Illumination. Okay. Murakis. Murakis means the miniature paintings. Right, remember. Murakis. Collected by Darashikoh. Please write, remember. Collected by Darashikoh. Where they preserved this Murakis means Indian Official Library, London. Yeah, Indian Official Library, London. Murakis. Don't forget. Okay. Shahjahan, Jahangir. Then answer must be Jahangir, Zenith. Who presented Sir Isaac Oliver album to Jahangir? Come on, ma'am. Sir Thomas Rowe. Thereby, he signed the accord to establish trade settlement. And moreover, he was an opium addict. Rangila. Okay? The paintings of Abhinandranath Tagore are classified as revivalistic. Realistic, socialistic, impressionist. Can you give an example? Can you give an example of Abhinandranath Tagore? Anybody? Abhinandranath Tagore. Come on. Can you give an example? How many of you studied modern Indian history in detail, from prelims perspective as well as from mains perspective? Come on. Yeah, don't be mum. Yeah, you must express yourself. Bharat Mata paintings. Where we can come across Bharat Mata paintings? Why he drew? Why he constituted Bharat Mata paintings? Abhinandranath Tagore. When? Which event? Which event? Where it reflects aspirations of Indians. Aspirations of Indians. And to fight against the white racist regime or colonial regime or colonial legacy. Anybody? Bengal partition. No way. Where the resolution of partition of Bengal was declared by Lord Curzon. He was popularly called as father of imperialism. Correct, I remember. On October 16th, 1905. Isn't it? Yeah. Where there was an important movement, Vande Mataram movement, where that Vande Mataram concept, it was given by Madhav Malegaon. There are so many things are there. History only, no? Why our students, they are taking 4 years, 5 years, I don't know here, to clear civil services. 1 year egress preparation is enough, pa. 1 year. And the next year, at least 2 years, pa, enough. Yeah, not more than that. Sometimes 6 years. But we must admire, we must adore the patience where they used to exhibit Jadom Swadeshi and boycott movement. Ayyappa. What is this? Swadeshi and boycott movement. Didn't study? Swadeshi and boycott movement. Please try to remember. Swadeshi and boycott movement. Swadeshi and boycott movement. Isn't it? 1901 to 1903, 1903 to 1905, 1905 to 1908. These are the three important phases. Correct? I can remember. Okay, no problem. The revivalistic, no? Try to understand the themes first. The last question, this is the last question. Okay, Kalamkari painting refers to Kalamkari. Kalam means pen. Kari means craftsmanship. Okay, craftsmanship. Kari means, Kalam means without pen we cannot write, no? Kalam, pen, Kari, craftsmanship. Correct? Which are two important styles of Kalamkari painting? At least, yeah. Just a simple question. Which are two important modes of Kalamkari painting? Especially pertaining to South India. Correct? I remember. Later on, it made its strides towards Gujarat. Okay? I remember. Towards Gujarat. It made its strides. Come on, anybody? Come on. So easy, no? As soon as you will come across Kalamkari means the memory must come and dance, the concept must come and dance in your memory according to your tunes. There are two modes. Machilipatnam style. Machilipatnam style and Kala Asti style. Kala Asti style, which has got more relevance as well as popularity, means the Kala Asti style. Okay, try to remember Kala Asti style, where it is a hand painted cotton textile in South India. Okay, hand painted cotton textile in South India, handmade drawing on bamboo handicrafts in Northeast India. These are all the paintings belong to the tribal communities. Okay, try to remember a block painted. See, these are all the paintings associated with the tribal people, for your kind information. But a hand painted cotton textile in South India. Okay, today just we'll end this session. Tomorrow we will continue. Tomorrow we will also discuss the current events. Whatever the current events are there, for example, I heard this. Sorry, cool. Where? Come on here. Sorai Kovil. The painting practiced by the tribal communities. Okay? Birsa Munda Airport. And recently, where they awarded GI tag. Geographical indication tag. Correct? Right? Remember? Yeah, whatever it is there, tomorrow we will discuss. Okay? Definitely there will be questions with regard to culture. Maximum 4 to 5 questions from culture only. At least 2 to 3 questions from culture. Yeah. Apart from that, modern Indian history is there. Don't neglect medieval also. Yeah. If you neglect, no, they will neglect you. Okay? Try to remember. If you neglect, they will neglect you. That's why don't neglect.